All right. For those of you who don't know me, I'm a very recent addition to the Atlanta Angular co-organizers. This is like, what, my second or third meetup being a co-organizer. Yeah, so feel free to throw food at me at any moment. So I always feel like I deserve it up here. So yeah, today we have four different talks. I'm going to start out with the state of Angular. So I'm fresh back from Ng-conf, as you can see. And I just want to share like the stuff I learned there with all you guys. And we've got Ady here. He's doing one on the JavaScript interview process, is that right? And how to fix the problems with it.
Yep.
And Alan Mathews from CallRail, is that right? Yeah, on Jasmine specs and Ruby on Rails, and Angular development with Ruby on Rails, is that right? Cool. And then A, of course, our long-term organizer of the meetup on Ant design. So our sponsors are Cabbage, of course. Hopefully we'll continue to be sponsors, and this will be a consistent place we show up every day or every month. But I wanted to apologize, first of all, for the situations around today. It was sort of a perfect storm of the weather and conflicting schedule with the meeting up there and a Fox Theater event happening at the same time. So it was kind of a mess, but we made it work. So here we are. And Navomi, I don't know anything really about Navomi. I think the next slide is about Navomi. Yeah, so Navomi is one of our sponsors. They're looking for four full-stack software engineers with Node experience. If you're looking for that kind of job, feel free to apply. These slides we'll provide to you guys afterwards. So some of the events coming up. Refactor Tech's a big one. It's going to be a conference just downtown, like a few blocks from here. The focus of it is diversity and inclusion in tech, but there's, if I recall correctly, there's multiple tracks, tons of different topics in tech, including Angular. So, and it's really cheap. It's the full price is $250 for admission, and it's a three-day conference. So like, Ng-conf was four times that much, five times that much. And also, we've got a 20% off discount code for any members of this meetup. So when you're buying your ticket, definitely input that. So yeah, I definitely recommend everybody go if you, feel like it. And A here will be speaking on UX and the age of intelligence. So Google AMP Roadshow. It's a free event that Google's coming here for a day, I think, and there's going to be all sorts of workshops on AMP. I would love to, there's what's AMP. Off the top of my head, I'm not actually sure what AMP is, other than what it says here, Accelerated Mobile Pages. You have anything to say about it?
I'm taking the workshop. I think it's the only workshop that's free. I highly recommend it if you already are going to Refactor Tech. I only tapped into AMP like maybe 3 years ago when it just was kind of relatively new, and I was really excited about it. Where it's going with as far as like mobile accessibility and owning that kind of stuff.
And of course, Connect Tech, it's a huge conference coming in October, and I believe they're still looking for speakers, so if anyone is interested, definitely check it out. Go to the website, apply to be a speaker. I'm considering doing something on Angular. See if that happens.
Definitely Angular people on the track, so if you guys are interested in speaking for your first time, don't be afraid. This is actually a great place to actually have a talk. I actually did a talk there last year. I didn't know I was having to do it till like a couple days beforehand, but I have to say it was a really good experience. And, people are really receptive and
your time, just go ahead. So I wanted real quick, we have another person here at Cabbage. We just started this new meetup here in .NET meetup here in the office. So Josh from Cabbage is here to talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, hey everyone.
So yeah, just recently started Midtown.net. Definitely go check it out. The first meetup is June 11th. It's on there. One of the main topics we'll be talking about is like .NET migrations to core, what they're doing, what they're not doing. There's two other people that are going to be speaking. Their topics, they're still talking about what they want to do, but it should be fun. Yeah, trying to get it big down here. So.
Cool. So, I think this is our next meetup. Is that right?
Yeah, we're still kind of on the. Wrangler is our sponsor.
Mm-hmm.
We're looking for topics, speakers, any suggestions. This is, you know, this meetup is your meetup. It's not ours. So, if you guys have an idea and you want to speak or something, by all means, come to any of us. We're more than happy to give you the platform.
Yeah, we're definitely looking for more. If like you're sort of new and you want to give your first talk. Like, it's totally fine to come to us for like a 10, 15 minute talk, 5 minute talk even. Just want it to be an awesome platform for anyone to like start speaking. And a little bit about Cabbage before we get started. So we're a financial tech company. You're in the office right now. What we do is basically write a product that is small business lending. And the way it works is customers, they sign up, they connect all of their data channels, so Facebook, that's a bad example, their bank account, QuickBooks, eBay, anything they use to run their business that has data that could help us figure out how they run their business. We take all that in, and machine learning models run on all that stuff and spit out a number, which is how much we lend them. And all that happens in just a few minutes. So we're sort of expanding now into being more than just a lending company. We call it CFAS, Cash Flow as a Service. So we've got a payments product we're building. We've got insights, basically analyzing business data to sort of tell business owners things about their business they didn't necessarily know. And there's a lot more planned, and it's a lot of work. Oh, our back end is .NET Core, hence the .NET meetup, and we do use Angular on the front end. My team, we're definitely using Angular 7 where we can, whatever is the latest, but a lot of the apps are still on Angular 4, but they're all being upgraded over time. Anyway, feel free to grab me afterwards if you have any questions or want to talk. So that's it for the intro. So I'm already hooked up to the mic, so I'm just going to go ahead and start. This is my first talk ever, I'll say, so bear with me here. I'm using this free software called slides.com. And I need to click some special button to go into presenter mode. Okay, give me a text message. Okay. Oh, full screen. Nope. So my talk's on the state of Angular. Fresh off the boat from Ng-conf, so I've got a lot of stuff to share. It's a lot of information, but bear with me. I think the stuff about Angular 8 is especially useful, just knowing what's coming. And for newer people or people that are using older versions of Angular, I'm dedicating a large portion of the talk to like the latest frameworks and the latest changes, the newest developments happening now in Angular that people are using, what methodologies, what frameworks you need to know about, and what new features of Angular the team has been really working on. So a little bit about me. Name's Matt Gold. I'm a senior software engineer here at Cabbage. I do full stack, but lately I've been focusing a lot on front end and trying to get really involved in the Angular community. Like I said earlier, just recently became a co-organizer of this meetup. I love audiobooks, I love video games, I love all sorts of stuff. Talk to me later if you want to find out more. So there's my Twitter and my email. All right, so ng-conf. Like I said, I just got back from ng-conf. It's May 1st to 3rd. I don't know if that's every year, but it was this year in Salt Lake City, and it was the original Angular conference, and I want to say it's the biggest in the world. They don't claim that, but I think last year their numbers were 1,500 plus people, and I haven't seen a total headcount for this year, so I can't post that, but it's a lot. And it's amazing. Like, you walk in, the hotel's beautiful. They have like PS4 set up on every corner with like video games, and like, it's crazy. But also 3 days of great talks. Like, a huge portion of the Angular team was at this conference, and we're giving talks and workshops. So straight from the mouth of like the people creating the framework, they're here to like, you know, teach you all the latest features, unveil like new stuff coming. So it's a lot of fun. It's kind of pricey, but if you can convince your company to send you, definitely try next year. Also, NG Atlanta in January is another great Angular conference. And parties every night, and this is the first time I ever sang karaoke in my entire life, so I felt like it deserved a spot on the slide. All right, so like I said, I'm going to start with the current state of Angular. What you need to know about now, what does the current ecosystem look like? You know, I pulled up my phone to do this from my phone, and I'm over here on my laptop. Okay. So my first big takeaway from like day one was just how many different products span Angular today in 2019. Brad Green from Google actually pointed this out and made the point that Angular at this point is a lot more than just a framework. It's more of a platform for building, testing, debugging your apps. All of that stuff is sort of integrated now through the CLI, and that's the direction they're moving. So a lot of these things you've probably seen before, you know, Router, Forms, Augury, but there's also lots of new products they're developing. Universal's been around, but lots of efforts going into that. You have Angular Elements, which is fairly recent, and Labs is a new effort at Google to a process for getting new features into the framework. So you'll be here, you'll be seeing more added to this list pretty soon. As far as Angular growth, Brad shared with everybody the unique visitors to their Angular.io site, and that grew more than 50% in 2018 with, 115 million a month? I can't count how many zeros that is. The point is, Angular is growing. It's not stagnant. And with that growth, we have my thing's not caught up. All the supporting frameworks and methodologies that go with Angular, those have all been evolving and maturing over time too. Not going over there. So with that, like, what does the current ecosystem look like? What tools are people using to build their apps? I want to start with Angular CLI because you're probably already using it, even if you don't know it. If you're using any version of Angular that's in the last 2 years, you're using CLI. And CLI is a lot more than just a command line interface. It manages your entire project for you. So through the command line, you can serve your app, build your app, test your app, lint your app, manage all of your dependencies, seamlessly upgrade Angular with ng update. You can even extend the functionality of the CLI with this thing called builders, which I'll get into later. And a fairly recent new addition to the CLI is schematics, which lets you, so when you like run ng new or ng generate, sorry, ng generate component, what that's running underneath is a schematic. And now we can write our own schematics and scaffold out our own code automatically. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So yeah, like I said, schematics really let you do two things. You can either create new code or edit existing code. And they let you, it's actually really surprisingly simple. When you write your schematic, you just give it a set of options that will accept on the command line. What type is it? What description you want to prompt on the screen when it asks for the parameter. And then you have this simple function that gives you the schematic context, which includes things like the logger, and lets you start writing code with a very, very simple like templating engine. And updating new code is a little more interesting. Instead of just writing strings, you have to work with like a nested parsed code tree and like figure out where you're going to inject new things. It's a little too much for this talk, though, so I'll move on. Oh my
god. You didn't press it.
I didn't press it. All right, so Angular Console is another fairly recent project that's becoming supported by Angular. It was developed by Narwhal, which is a big name in the Angular world, if you haven't heard of them. What it basically is just a user interface for the CLI. The CLI is super important already, but what this does is not all of us like to like use a command line all day, and I'm one of them. I prefer like a nice UI where I can see everything at once. Hey, what's up?
I just got here, but I'm in the back and I can't hear you very well, so if you want to speak up, maybe other people would like it too.
Okay, I'll try. I'm almost at like max volume, I feel like. I don't really project my voice very well, but just kidding. So yeah, what I like about it, it lets you intuitively explore the full capabilities of the CLI. Super simple to install and just open up. But Narwhal also makes this product called NX, which is a set of schematics, really, really awesome, gigantic schematics that do so much more than the built-in ng generator, ng new. It creates an entire workspace for you that includes not just front-end, but also back-end. It lets you manage multiple projects at the same time. They have schematics for not just the built-in Protractor and Karma, but also Cypress, a new end-to-end testing framework, Jest, Nest on the back end, which I'll get into a little bit later. Nest is an amazing framework. And all of this, it sort of scaffolds out in the same project structure used at Google. So it's meant to scale, pretty much. So definitely check out the NX schematics if you haven't already. And Console will actually sort of gently push you to use NX. You don't really have to look for it. If you just open up Console and look at the schematics libraries, you'll find NX in the dropdown. I did it. I can't resist. So Angular Universal, another product that's been around for a little while, but the team has been investing a lot of energy into this. It lets you run Angular anywhere, but what this really means effectively is people use it for server-side rendering. Server-side rendering has several benefits. It improves your load times. It works like a request comes in. The server sort of renders your page, gives it back to the client, and you have that to display immediately instead of waiting for your app to like load Angular and you know just-in-time compile your components or whatever. So initial load times are great, but what that pre-rendered image of your site also gives you is improved SEO and site previews. Like you know when you post a link on Twitter and they give you the little preview of what the website looks like, it's a lot easier for these tools to do that if you're using server-side rendering. But I will say, definitely be careful with it. It's not just a simple plug-and-play feature. I learned this from experience. You have to sort of plan from the start how you're going to hand that state from the server to the client. So just be careful if you plan on using Angular Universal, definitely do your homework and think about how you're going to architect it. Angular Elements, another recent product from Angular that a ton of energy has been invested into. So what this is Angular's way of doing web components. Web components are just a set of browser specs that let you register custom elements into any web page. A custom element being like your own custom HTML tag that has scripts and templates running inside of it that can be rendered anywhere in a browser, independent of framework or whatever else the browser has loaded. It's sort of a self-contained component. So use cases for this, like why would you want something like this? The one you'll run into a lot is, well, you can run Angular components in a React app, or you can run Angular components in sites that don't have Angular. So you can do that, but some of the more interesting things you can do with this, because you just have a DOM element you're working with, you can dynamically lazy load your own Angular app by using Angular Elements. So if you have your elements already set up, because they're just DOM elements, you can just use JavaScript to insert this element onto the page, and you're suddenly composing your app dynamically, which Angular doesn't really play. It doesn't play nicely with that kind of stuff without this. But taking that concept even further, these elements don't even need to be part of your app. You could write a bunch of Angular components and deploy them to separate servers and have your app pull those in and then render them dynamically. So on the same page, you could sort of compose a dashboard where you have different teams at your organization maintaining each section. So that's one of the cooler things you can do with elements. That's not immediately obvious. So testing frameworks, really quickly go over this. Angular has been shipping with Karma and Protractor for a while, and I want to say they're now both like officially supported by Angular since they have these fancy icons in their press kit. But a lot of people don't like Karma and Protractor. Jest is a newer testing tool that lets you run your Jasmine specs without a browser. You can just run them in Node, which is great. It also has plenty of other additions to just plain Jasmine. And Cypress just totally changes the way you write your integration tests. It runs in the browser instead of controlling a separate browser interacting with your app. It's way easier to write tests. It's fast, and it lets you time travel. You can see like the result of each step of the test. It's really cool. If you haven't seen it, definitely look at it. But builders for these things exist already. So it's already possible to integrate these into your app using Angular CLI if you don't like Protractor or if you don't like Karma. Nope, not going to do it. So I wanted to cover state management a bit because this is an extremely important concept for any medium, large-sized app you're going to build. And there are tons of frameworks to do this. I don't really have a lot of time, so I could probably spend hours talking about state management, but I'm just going to quickly skip over this. Basically, you've all run into that situation where you have two different components that are totally unrelated, and they need to talk to each other. And you think, oh, maybe I can just use inputs and outputs to, uh-oh, my computer went to sleep. Fantastic. Maybe I should, yeah. It should just stay at the computer. Nope. Long story short, it makes it very easy to share state between any components in your app. You have a global store of state and a very clear, predefined pipeline for how events flow into creating new state and managing side effects of these events. It's all handled really well, and it does a lot for you. Everything's totally decoupled. It solves a lot of problems if you start building your app with State Manager from the beginning. There's plenty of frameworks that people are using for this. NgRx is still the biggest. Most of these are reactive, so they all use RxJS to manage your events, since Angular already ships with RxJS. It's sort of a natural way to do it. NgXS sort of evolves on NgRx a little bit by using TypeScript features a little more intelligently to reduce a lot of boilerplate and make it easier to use. Akita is a more object-oriented approach to state management. And if you're into GraphQL, there's a brand new framework called Luna, which is a GraphQL state management library for your Angular app that uses RxJS. It just seamlessly connects to Apollo and does all of that for you. But I don't think many people are using it yet. It's pretty new. One last thing before getting to Angular 8. Nest.js, if you haven't heard of it, definitely check it out. It's an amazing back-end framework. It's a server-side framework. And the only reason I mention it here is the patterns that you use in Nest are almost identical to Angular. So if you know Angular, you already pretty much know how to write code in Nest. It gives you dependency injection, middleware, filters, interceptors, all of these same concepts. It's all very declarative, using like TypeScript features like decorators instead of the callback hell that sort of happens with Express apps. So that's all I'll say about it, but it's growing a lot. It had a huge presence at the conference, so definitely give it a look if you're not familiar. So the future of Angular, Angular 8 and beyond, which is mostly just Angular 8 because I don't know very much about the beyond. But I'm going to start with, quick summary. So At a glance, Ivy and Basil, those are the two big things coming to Angular, which I'll get into in a sec. The rest of this are nice to haves, but those are the two big guys. Real quick, the timeline for this stuff. Version 8, release candidate 3 is already out. You can already install it. So that means the final version is right around the corner. Any day now, they should release Angular 8. And Angular 9 is expected in quarter 4, 2019. And I think the general idea is they want to release every 6 months-ish. So the Ivy renderer is probably the biggest thing coming. The pattern it follows for rendering is called incremental DOM instead of virtual DOM, and I'll get into that in the next slide. But basically what this is going to give you is improved tree shaking, which gives you smaller payloads, you're going to have faster builds, and much, much lower memory requirements in your app. The code it generates is a lot more readable than the last renderer, and they actually support breakpoints, and template errors will be in your error stack traces now. So I know you've all run into the issue where you have a bug in your template and the stack trace just doesn't make any sense. So that's all going to be fixed with Ivy. You can use it in Angular 8 opt-in by passing this enable Ivy flag into your ng new command, but it'll be the default renderer in Angular 9. And Angular made it very clear, the team made it very clear at the conference that it's their highest priority right now, all hands down on Ivy. So a little bit about virtual versus incremental DOM. So virtual DOM is a concept that I think React invented, and I think React still uses it, Angular 7 uses it. Basically, every time the app is rendered, you have this, what do they call it, component, basically a tree of elements in your component in a virtual DOM. And all of that's in memory, and every single rendering cycle, it compares the current virtual DOM with the last one. And if there are any differences, it'll generate instructions to update the actual DOM to match. So here's an example of something changes. It detected it. You've got a different tree. With incremental DOM, which is this new concept that Angular Ivy is going to use, everything is instructions from the start. There's no concept of a DOM tree. There's no interpretation happening on the front end. You immediately just get a set of basic browser DOM instructions to run your app, and events are already, changes are already handled with those initial instructions. So you don't have anything really in memory except when something changes. And another side effect of that is that tree shaking is improved because if something in your app is never used, if you have something in your template that is referenced, something in your component that's not referenced by something in your template, no instructions will ever be generated for that. So it just doesn't get loaded by the browser. So Basil is the other big thing coming with Angular 8. It's also going to be opt-in, so not totally ready, not totally stable, but you can use it. So currently when you run ng build in your application, all that's really doing is calling Webpack. Webpack bundles up your stuff, and you have your bundles ready to load. So Basil is a gigantic change. It's a much more like generic build tool, sort of like Gulp. And the reason the Angular team is doing this, the reason they're bringing this in is because this is what Google does internally. They have gigantic apps. They have hundreds of apps. They have crazy requirements of how fast they need to build. And like the basic Webpack configuration that ships with Angular doesn't really fit with them. So they have this effort that they're trying to bring their internal tools that they use to the rest of us so we can scale like Google scales. So with Basil, basically the way it works is it analyzes all of your build files and all of their dependencies and creates a sort of graph of how all the different steps involved in the build, what tools need to be run where, and which dependencies sort of fit in. And then all of that gets cached when the build happens. And if a single file is changed, it can look up that graph and know exactly which part of the graph needs to be rebuilt. So that gives us incremental builds. We only build the bare minimum of what needs to be built when the file changes. So you're going to have much, much faster builds generally, especially as you change your app in watch mode. Builds are going to be faster because of that. Also, it's full stack, so Bazel has nothing really to do with JavaScript. You can use it with Java, you can use it with C++, you can use it on your backend, and this is sort of what Google does. They want one build environment for all of their stuff. So they're giving us that option with Bazel. Runs on Linux, Mac, and very recently Windows. It's extensible. You can easily write your own plugins to Bazel. And the coolest thing about it is this feature called remote build execution lets you parallelize Bazel builds in the cloud. So this is how Google achieves their crazy requirements of how quickly their builds need to run. They just scale up, add more servers in the cloud, and that's about all the detail I can give you. I don't know exactly what they're doing. But yeah, again, this is going to be opt-in with Angular 8 and should be the default Angular 9, I think. All right, so the rest of the features. Differential loading is pretty simple. All this means, this is coming in Angular 8, instead of that problem where you're unsure of like how many polyfills you need to include, you don't know what browsers you're going to support, Angular is just going to serve one bundle for legacy browsers that have fully ES5 syntax, so you know it's going to work, full polyfills, so you know that you're covered. And then if a modern browser is requesting the app, they get a different bundle that has modern ES6 or plus syntax and reduced polyfills. So the end result is that if you're in a modern browser, you're just automatically going to get a smaller payload. And they are already using this on Angular.io, and they, at the conference, mentioned a 20% savings in their bundle sizes. So it's definitely nice to have. So CLI builders, these have already been around for a little bit, but they've never officially been supported and part of Angular. If you've ever looked at your Angular JSON and noticed that architect section and wondered what the hell that is, that's where builders does its thing. So all a builder is a way to, it's a module of the CLI. It's a task that runs in the CLI. So ng build is a builder. Ng test is a builder. These are just simple functions that lets you define the arguments that you can pass into them, because we're talking about a CLI program. You write arguments. It gives you access to the CLI context, which gives you access to the logger. You can output build progress, all this other stuff. And the coolest thing about it is it supports watch mode. So you could write your own builder that will automatically reload the browser, just like ng-serve does when you change something in your app, just by emitting something on an observable. So you run your own builders with ng-run. Like I said, these have been around for a while. There's already very mature builders out there, custom builders out there for Cypress and Jest, and Angular has been using them internally in the framework for a while. But in Angular 8, this is officially part of Angular. It's supported. The API was revised a little bit, but it's nice to actually have this. We know this is going to be a thing in the future, so we can start using these and committing to them. Just real quick, a quick screenshot of the part of Angular JSON that deals with builders. So if you wrote your own, you'd have your own little entry here. So a few other minor changes. Lazy loading, you know, currently when you use load children and you're lazy loading a module, you have to write your little magic string pointing to the module. Now it's going to just use the browser's native import function, which is really cool. You'll have better type safety around that. Web workers are just background threads that run in the browser. The requirement with those is they have to have their own separate JavaScript files that need to be bundled separately. So Angular will now support bundling web workers, making sure that's not in the rest of the app code. Router backwards compatibility with AngularJS. If you're still using AngularJS, I'm sorry. And also just generic dependency upgrades, new TypeScript version, new Rx, that kind of stuff. So almost done. Angular 9 and the future. So Angular 9, they plan Bazel to be stable. So hopefully like that's going to be the default build tool we use. And ng-build will actually call Bazel. Angular Ivy will be the default renderer. So all of those awesome benefits are just going to be given to us. The team outlined just a bunch of general commitments that they're going to use for all future versions of Angular. One of them is backwards compatibility. So you should never again have to update your application code to upgrade your app. They are really like committed to the CLI doing all of that for you. So ng update or ng upgrade should be able to update your code if there's anything that needs to be updated. You shouldn't have to think about, oh, I need to update, let me figure out what things need to change, are there any syntax differences? They want it to be super simple. Great developer experience, it sort of falls into that. They're trying to unify their documentation, make all of this make a lot more sense, so there's a lot of effort going to that. Performance, as you can tell from Angular 8 changes, Ivy and Bazel, they're definitely focused on that, and that's only going to continue, so expect a huge focus on performance in future versions of Angular. And the community is the last big thing. Angular community is great. I can personally attest to that just from going to a couple of conferences, but Angular is really, the Angular team at Google is really invested in the community, and they're actually starting to pull in contributors from GitHub into the Angular team. So like last year, they call this Angular Collaborators, and they have a formal program for GitHub contributors to join the Angular team if they become a big enough part of the framework. And I think they said by the end of the year, they'll have 40 people pulled into the Angular team that way. That should be it. Yep, so that's it. Again, here's my info. Here's some resources, incremental DOM, CLI builders, Angular 8, all this cool stuff. Another thing I wanted to point out is RxJS totally just redid all their documentation and nobody really knew about it. So definitely check out rxjs.dev. They're totally changed their approach to how you learn Rx. That's all I got. So thanks for your time and thanks for letting me go so far over. All right, who's up next?
I believe I am.
Out of your shirt, and then hopefully you have one of these sweet flippy pockets.
All right. Yeah. I have this old school stuff. Good? I have reach, so. Still going to, what do I need to do here?
Oh, sorry, just click share.
Share, and I'm good, okay.
And then PC,
there you go.
Share
button. All right.
There you go.
All right, well, okay. Hello, everyone. I'm Ady, A-D-Y. I found out that like that was short for Audrey, so sometimes I showed up at job interview, they were expecting somebody else. I'm a guy. So real quick here, any basketball fan? Okay, tough crowd. pick any team. Atlanta is out, so pick any team to win. All right, I'm going to pick, I don't know. I like the Rockets this year. All right, so what we're going to do, we're going to talk about this in a few seconds, but you did not know coming here that you were going to be involved in a trivia. You did not even know that you were going to be part of a team. So I'm going to take team one, team two, team three. You better like each other because, man, you know, it's going to be on you. So first question, and I'm going to be showing my age here. But the thing is, you are most likely to guess even though you're not basketball fans. So who was the NBA most valuable player twice in a row in 1989 and 1990? I'm going to give you four choices. Larry Bird, Michael Jordan, Magic Johnson, or Kobe Bryant?
Magic Johnson.
Magic
Johnson?
Magic? Michael Jordan? And it goes for Magic, so you split the point. It was Magic Johnson. So we got one. Second one, a little tighter. What is the correct NBA three-point line distance? Is it 23 feet, 75 the longest, and 22 in the corners? 22 longest and 21 in the corners, or 30 longest and 25 in the corners? So 23, 22, 22, 21, 30, 25. Just take a guess.
30?
30? 30? Wrong. 23, 22. And then finally, the last question. Who was the best prospect out of college coming into the NBA? Kobe or LeBron? It's a 50-50.
It's Kobe.
It's Kobe?
They never went to college.
Oh, both? I know LeBron didn't.
LeBron didn't go to
college. There you go. We got a winner right there. None of them went to college. Okay? So, enough with the trivia for now. You're going to say like, oh, we're here for JavaScript interview questions. What do we have to do with basketball? Well, you are in a JavaScript interview, like, you know, process in the actual state of it anyway. So, just let's take a quick scenario. Now, put yourself in the shoes of a general manager. You have to hire or you have to recruit another point guard, you know? And then you tell your scouts, go get me somebody. I need him to be able to shoot and everything, and all the things that you need. They come back, 4 weeks later, they have nobody. And you're like, what is going on? I see a lot of people, they are good on the paper, I see their stuff and everything like that, but your team tells you, well, they're not able to throw a football. What does football have to do with recruiting people for basketball? Unfortunately, that's the state of the JavaScript interview today. We have taken one of the most popular language as of today, turn the recruiting process into a trivial happy process. So we have this large funnel, and then we ask people, what is the closure? What is the difference between like loose equality or like, you know, strict equality? And then you're all happy about it. You're like, oh, I know this. I go online, that's the 30 most popular like JavaScript interview questions. I'm working at this. You go in there, and you have one guy who maybe you have dated his sister, and he was not happy about it. And he tells you, like, you know, about, like, you know, partials, about, you know, the new one that we're hazing people with, functional programming. So from the point where you are coming in as a prospect, and the moment you walk in into the building, it's two different universe. So what I'm proposing here is from the get-go, let's not make it a trivia. It's very good to be in teams, talk about trivia, and even being right when you have no understanding or no knowledge about basketball. And that's the danger. That's what trivia does. You might be right because you're playing a guessing game. It doesn't show your like skill. It doesn't show your depth. It doesn't show your knowledge. So right now, I am at 8 questions that I'm crafting myself, kind of giving it a different angle. People are going to tell me, oh, no, Fizzbuzz is not you, man. Don't claim on that one. I have tried that one. But you will see how we go about it. So I'm going to take about, what, 5 more minutes? I know it's a very light talk. And we're going to go into, like, how to approach the interviewing process, into, like, just giving a little twist to the way that we question things. So you can pick any. I mean, just let me know which one, like, sounds good to you. Pick any number. Come on, guys. Just pick a number.
Three.
Three. Calculate employee gross pay. Okay. We got to get paid at the end of the day. Yeah. So let me make sure that everybody can see this. That's good? Okay, so the wording is more like a user story. So if you are in Jira or anything like that in any team, you know what the user story is, and that's a love-hate relationship for most of us. So as a new member of the Core Inc. development, your new hot assignment is to help the HR department quickly calculate employees' gross pay. Below are the compensation models for each role, and that's an object that is going to be in there. And I'm asking you, write a base function that takes a role object, hours, and overtime hours as arguments, and returns the employee gross pay. Using this base function, create three partial functions. Using the base, create three partials that respectively will calculate the associate supervisor admin gross pay when invoked. It's very specific. It's very tied to a certain coding style. There's a very certain amount of knowledge about like what is being asked for. Some people here are comfortable with this because they might have like dealt with partials before. You might have even dealt with partial, but you don't know it. So it is going to be a two-way interview, because the thing is, some of this interview, the interview is not prepared at all. The interviewer is not as prepared as you are, and that's unfortunate. But this like will allow for the interviewer to be prepared, you know, to know the subject in depth, to be able to answer questions. If somebody has never heard about partial functions, everybody here is comfortable with partial functions? Yes, no? Or what they are? Okay, so it will be the responsibility of the interviewer to tell you what it is without giving you the solution. So the interviewer has to be prepared, not just give you a can of like, you know, pre-made questions and like asking you to just play a trivia game. So, and here I add for each of these, like, you know, a context, you know, and at the top I add to at what stage of the interview process this will be a best fit. You know, is that on site? Is that like for a senior developer? Is that for a junior developer? So we're not going to cover partials today. Let's take like a second example, the simple one, the Fizzbuzz challenge. And I believe that like the Fizzbuzz challenge sounds very simple at the top, but you can take it to town with an expert or a senior guy, you know, or a girl, of course, you know, for an hour if you wanted to. It just depends on how you approach and how you are asking the candidate to show and share knowledge. So everybody knows the Fizzbuzz here, I'm guessing. Everybody knows the Fizzbuzz in general. You know? Okay, let's go with that. Thank you. So write a program that prints the number from 1 to 100. But for multiples of 3, it's going to output fees. For multiples of 5, it's going to output buzz. And if it's both a multiple of 3 and 5, it's going to output fees buzz. That was my first JavaScript interview question 10 years ago. You know, actually, it was over the phone. I remember that very well. That made me sweat. I'm not going to front, you know. So, but the Fizzbuzz is not specific to JavaScript. It can be solved in many other programming language. But in a JavaScript context, what you will be looking for is somebody's like understanding of logical operators, looping, falsy values, ternary operator, and type coercion. All of that loaded into that one simple, like, you know, the way that you code, you know, might show like the depth of knowledge that you have. And of course, I have labeled this one from junior to senior, even to expert, because everybody will have a different take about it. But as this series evolves, I'm even proposing like an approach of how to like tackle this if you're in an interview setting. So if you are a beginner, that might be like, you know, a few good tips. If you are more advanced, you might be saying, hey man, you know what, this is crazy. This is a better approach, and then the community benefits from it. So please, you know, call me out on it. I really want that to happen. Now, in the solutions, you will see here that, you know, I'm going through that. I don't need to. The final step, let's go. Okay, let's say this is a first decent solution. Basically, you are using like the remainder operator here to get fees, another remainder operator here to get buzz, and then you're combining the two to get fees buzz. You know, pretty decent. It works, you know, but some of you might be like, why do I have to check for 3 and 5 again? And that might be like a valid interview question. The interviewer say like, okay, but the most important part is you got to the answer first. You know, most of the time people freeze in interview because they are already refactoring in their head and they're not talking about it. Deer in headlights. Sir, do I need to repeat the question? And they're like, you know, so don't do that. Get to the bottom of it, get a working solution, and then progress from it. From that, I went all the way, and I'm talking about the refactor process, and this is my favorite, that's my personal favorite JavaScript way of solving for this challenge. Because I am doing like type coercion here, and I'm using an OR operator to be able to do it in one pass. So in a nutshell, I mean, we have a very limited time today. What I want to propose is that we all know that at some point, for example, I work at Ernst & Young right now as a solution designer, a JS tech lead there. And for the last 4 or 5 months, we've been having problems filling out a role. And when I looked at our process, I could see a big smell in there. We need to fix the process. So I'm trying, and I'm starting like with these questions. And I need the help from everybody from the community. That's all I have for today. And of course, I'm on dev too, ADY and GOM on GitHub. And some of my friends, and this is where you might be able to help us a lot, some of my friends started taking these questions and started like putting it into their process already. And one of the feedback that I got, and this guy doesn't give you anything for free. I mean, he's like, he's a good critic. He's like, meaning that if he says it, he means it, you know? So he says, those are some very interesting questions and setups. What I like most is that they are not purely algorithmic theoretical. This is not the Google, crack the Google interview. That's not what I'm trying to do here. They are not purely algorithmic, but really give you a good feel for the candidate's real world experience. That's invaluable. Hopefully you will find it invaluable too and you'll contribute. Let's talk about it afterwards. Thank you. Again. Ady Ngom on Twitter. Yes, just my name.
Anybody have any questions?
Any questions?
So you're saying that FizzBuzz is a relevant JavaScript question or it is not?
It can be a relevant question depending on how we approach the questioning of it. Yeah. Yeah.
Sorry.
Uh-huh.
But so you have a GitHub, and so that was like just an example from the GitHub, and you want us to like trick.
Yeah, so it's an actual GitHub like repo. I can share it in the group meetup page. This is I pretty much put this together with GitHub pages today, but there's an actual like repo on it. And then yes, of course. Go in there and you know, fork it and submit like some new questions. I submitted like on Medium and on DevTools. The people are responding well to the article, but the best way is for developers to come on GitHub and get the conversation going, you know, and look at the solutions in there and like propose more questions. It's been like 3 months and I only came up with 8 questions, so it's gonna take a while if I try doing it by myself. Yeah. Anything else?
I just had a statement. I am not really I don't know much about JavaScript, but for you to come here and say that through the interview process that there is, you're not being very, you're not being tested in a way where you could show off all your skills or what you know about JavaScript, kind of opens my eyes to how I approach it in the future.
Alrighty, thank you so much. Yeah. Good. Yeah.
Have you been able to kind of like test this with candidates
I have been able to test it, yes. Getting to the point where knowing if they if they are high performance a little too soon. But it's very promising because it's kind of like, basically it's making sure people kind of go outside of the box. People come with a different, and in some cases I even gave the candidate the questions before they came to the interview. Because, you know, you can memorize something, but as soon as we change the FeesBest challenge to say, like, you know, print out any prime number, the whole, like, you know, it changes. So if you just memorized something and you come in there and you don't have depth, it shows right away. So I made it more conversational and less of, like, I'm trying to get you to show you to show you that I know better than you. Which is sometimes, unfortunately, in our industry, we got that from interviewers, you know? So it's been more collaborative. And then on two occasions, I had like one candidate who totally showed me like a better way of doing something, just because like it was. So I think it's a work in process right now, but I'm very confident that it's gonna be like, you know, bearing fruit pretty soon. Yeah.
So we had a meetup
interviewing. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, most definitely. I'd be really glad to do that. We good? And then, of course, this is growing into 28 questions for Angular. It's gonna come, React, and everything else. We're starting with JavaScript because it's the base, and then we will, like, you know, branch out into other areas. But yeah, can I go now? I'm good. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. No problem. No. Sit down. I'll just sit there. Yeah, you have to touch the share button. I'm going to act like I know the stuff now. Yeah, touch on the right here. And then, there you go.
How do I find my laptop or my desktop here? Yeah. You saw the car on my background. I don't own that. I don't drive it. That's just it's the dream. Cool. All right. Everyone can see that? Everyone's good? Okay. I'm Alan. I'm a software engineer at CallRail. I've been full-time there for the past about 3.5 years now. The topic of my talk today is, where did the factories go? This is a Jasmine Angular specs from a Rails point of view. So hopefully I probably won't tell anyone anything new here, because you sound like most of you are all JavaScript people. but hopefully you'll gain something out of it. And it's only about 10 or 11 slides anyway, so it'll be over fairly fast. And then I'll give you life back. But a little bit about me. Again, I'm Alan, Call Rail, software engineer. And a quick background, I'm a non-normal dev in the sense that I didn't go to school for it. Like I don't have a bachelor from any school. I did go to a boot camp here in Atlanta called the Iron Yard. They had campuses throughout the U.S. And then self-taught stuff, everything from Code Academy, Treehouse, and things like that. So I'll get started. Again, the topic is where do the factories go? Factories, what are they? I'm going to explain this from the point of view of what they mean to me. There might be factories in the sense of some form of the same thing in Jasmine or another Angular testing framework or something like that. So feel free to update me on that, but I'm just going to go from where I would approach it. It has a Rails guy. So factories in this case are going to be essentially anything that's going to create a database object. An example here, it's articles.rb. So the factory would essentially create a article instance for me to then use in the spec itself. Interesting things you can do with factories, you can pass certain traits. So you could have a trait of a published article, a non-published article in the future, in the past. But essentially, this is a way that, like, as a Ruby person and a object-oriented, this is the way that I would kind of approach my thinking of writing specs. Is I have this object, I'm doing something with it. It's a representation of what's in my testing database at the time. Writing Jasmine specs was a kind of total kind of shock because in the sense that there is no obviously database object for me to create and run methods with. So in the next slide, let's see, it's predefined values, collection of dates. So in order to create them, as I said, the biggest advantage here would be to test real objects. So there's no mocks, no spies, stubs, anything like that. You're doing it with a real database object. The helpful thing is this guy right here, complex associations. Going back to the articles thing, you could have your factory create an article, create a publisher, create anything that would be involved with either like a blog post or a book. You could run this command right here, and purely by the fact that if you defined in your factory spec for an article that it needs to create three other database associations, you can then have that essentially create this kind of all-encompassing thing that would be not impossible to kind of mock or create a kind of a double for. It'd be very time consuming. And they're great for being able to test what would be in your app in the real world. Once you've got your factory set up, and there's a certain amount of work that you have to do prior. Obviously, for any writing any spec, you do have to do a certain amount of build prior. But then you can simply run build factories via RSpec, which is the main Ruby testing framework. You have a couple different options. You can create a factory, so actually create a real database rail. You can run build stubbed. We'll essentially model a object for you, but without actually writing it to the database. And then you essentially then have, if you had a article object and there was a database column for title for whatever article you wrote, you can then have your spec set up and then run an expect and have content of your article title that is under test there. factories and how can they be harmful? For me, I'll start with the first one. First off, they're slow. You are creating and reading and writing to your database. This is a trivial example here, but if you went, so if you work at an app the size of my company has, we have, I think, hundreds of files for all of our specs. Creating an object every time that you wanted to simply test that something's true or false, that could take an incredibly long time. It also gives you a false sense of knowing what's going on, because if someone has set up the factory prior to you getting there, you get the benefit of all the hard work that they created, but also it doesn't let you dive into the way that your app is kind of doing its data modeling. And it's great when you're first starting out, but if you try and make a switch away from using factories to using a mock or hard double, it quickly will, you'll get quickly bogged down in having to actually think about what is actually this article object, simply just beyond that it gets created by this kind of factory in another file and you don't really have to worry about it. And again, going back to two sentences, it's unnecessary. Our spec does have a instance double. So instead of creating the factory like I did in the previous example of calling build the article, I can just create an instance double of the factory. You can pass it whatever database column attributes that you want to set. And then at this point, you can essentially achieve the same spec, but it's, in this case, it's an object that's built in memory instead of actually writing to the database. And you get a huge performance boost out of that. So gotchas as a Ruby dev. Nothing quite like FactoryBot in Jasmine or writing Angular specs. I'm sure you could create a service or a component file that would be able to be imported and injected in and create something for you that would be an object that would be what you need on a test instead of having to manually kind of hand define everything at the top of your file. I've found that Jasmine, at least in kind of the way that we write specs in my work, we tend to lean heavily more on spies, mocks, and doubles. Again, that's a new world coming for me, because essentially you just all you had to do was FactoryBot create or build, and you have an object, and you don't have to kind of mock anything out or write a spy or anything like that. It felt like at first for me as well, lots of manual setup, because my kind of thought process is, okay, well, if I need an article, or I, you know, essentially, why wouldn't pass in a whole object back up to the front end? It's a JSON object that would represent an article. And so I would go about trying to mock this article in the Angular file, and I would, you know, create every attribute, because that's the way my thinking was, okay, if it's an article, it's got a name, it's got a title, it has a publisher, it's got a date, it has all the things, so I'm writing all this stuff out, and then I realized, like, okay, well, all I'm really trying to test here is just the name of the article. I don't need to like kind of create this giant long JSON object of what the actual article appears in the database. It's less complex than I was leaning towards. And as I said, this was kind of a new world for me in terms of writing kind of mocks and doubles, and it brought me to a point of kind of seeing how valuable it is to write all this out for yourself as you write the specs, rather than just simply having kind of a factory thing that does something in the background. Also, weird little things. I know, like for y'all, I'm sure it's kind of quite boring and lame, but it was kind of also approaching a new testing framework and like how do you write a stub for something. And it was, I think the first time I wrote Angular specs, I think I sat on my screen for probably about 20 minutes, like staring at it and thinking, like, I don't know how to write code anymore. It was a very shell shock thing of all of a sudden, like, I was actually, for the first few times that I did it, I would actually write commented out lines of what I would write in RSpec, and it helped me kind of model what I needed to write in Jasmine. But essentially, it's if you wanted to. I do like the syntax that Jasmine has. I think it reads better. I try and think of tests as a way to, at least it forced you to write in English what it is that you're trying to do. Because everyone likes clean syntax and one line kind of pieces of code, but they can be terse, and especially if you're new, hard to read. I think it's kind of using to have been called for whether or not a method was called on this foo object actually reads slightly better than telling expect to this foo object to receive set bar. They achieve the same thing, but just again, there's a little gotchas as it has a Ruby guy switching over to writing a little bit more Jasmine. The concept of a spy object was also, I thought, very cool. To my knowledge, I don't think RSpec has anything like that. So essentially, you can create a, in this case, for this example, kind of a tape object. Then you can be able to tell that you'll call four different methods on it, play, pause, stop here. I don't think RSpec has anything like that. I think you have to create essentially every method that you want to test on a kind of per spec run. So I thought that was, again, for most of y'all, it's probably not something that you find too interesting, but it was for me. And so yeah, a couple highlight, kind of high level kind of takeaways. As I said, moving away from FactoryBot and moving away from something that creates these things for you and creates, I guess, a false sense of kind of understanding of knowing what's going on in your code base. I've transferred over a lot of what I've learned in terms of writing kind of mocks and doubles to writing more of that in RSpec. It can get a little crazy, especially at my job, because we have data models that have very complex associations that if you have a user, it creates three other tables that when you create a user. So it lets you, at least to me, it was just something kind of a powerful thing to be able to kind of hand build these things and not just kind of trust that a factory is going to do all the work for me. As I said, gaining a better model of how our data models work at my job. And one of the, as a code base, I think it's going on 10 years old now. We have a lot of specs, a lot of files. It does take a little bit of time for our whole spec suite to run, and being able to help not add to the problem. Obviously, we're going to be adding more specs as we go. There's no opportunity to take them out. But being able to at least kind of play a part and know that a lot of the work that I'm doing now when writing both Jasmine and our spec stuff is a little bit more on the fast side. And I think that's it. Yeah, it's I don't want to talk like I know everything. I had a presentation where I just said I didn't know all the stuff when I was writing Jasmine Strikes. But essentially, it's the way that I would think of it is a double for whatever object that I want to use under test. If you go all the way back, essentially, this is a stand-in for what would have been the actual article object that FactoryBot would have created for me. Yeah. Yeah.
But now Ruby was actually the first language I ever learned. Okay. Great,
yeah. Yeah. Yeah, now it has a clean syntax, but yeah.
Do you have a Twitter handle?
I do. It's at Alan underscore Mathews. I didn't bother to put any of my pull it up real fast, hopefully. If I can get it. No, a bunch of other Alan Mathews. Okay. Yeah, it's at Alan underscore Mathews underscore. GitHub, Mathews Allen. That's my last name, first name, last. Yeah.
Great, thank you.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Anybody really want to learn about ant design? It's not going to be real long.
How many people actually work on front-end stuff, like more design side? Okay, so the majority of you guys are developers, right? More code, back-end, okay. One of the reasons why I kind of want to give this talk about ant design, because I actually started a project with REAI, two great guys back there, and Sid there, who gave a talk on, what was the talk again? It was about AI. What was it called? TensorFlow. Yeah, I can't remember the name. Which was a great talk, by the way. It's a great project, and so in my experience being a UX product designer that consults sometimes, and I also work at Mobile App Hero, a lot of the smaller project we suffer from not having the funds or the time necessarily and the people, the manpower, to really have a really good solid team where you have somebody that's doing the UI design. Sometimes it's just the developer doing front and back, so you're really being a full stack. So ant design was actually brought up by Sid, because on this project we were talking about having things be consistent to streamline the process of certain concerns about best practices on UX and UI. So I'm going to talk more on the design side about ant design for you guys, because I think it's going to be more pertinent to you guys to gain some knowledge and how to help yourself when you're in a project that's dealing with a lack of UI or UX personnel to kind of advise you there. So bear with me here. When you get 50, it's hard to see what the keys are. Still something's not going on. Okay, there we go. Hey, so we're, oh, you plug it in, right? That helps. We have a fire port, or maybe a HDMI at the end, right? There we go. That makes it easy. That's the great thing about technology. It's supposed to make our lives easier, but there's not always quite the case, right?
Oh, you just tap share.
Where? Oh, on that, okay. That's weird. That's weird UX. Is that me? Yes, there we go. All right. So, ant design. What it's not. So, it's not an ant, obviously. Ant design is an open source, second largest React UI component library out there. It's actually created by Ant Financial, but it's basically an ant design system library. It's a design language. It practices best practices for UX, certain design patterns that you should follow, a lot of these principles that are pretty common in universal design, all the way from product to mobile design. But I find a lot of confusion sometimes happens with some developers that don't quite know or understand some of those. And we don't expect you to, because it's a lot to know even from a UX standpoint that deal with it on a daily basis. And so what this does is basically helps handle that for you. And it really kind of streamlines advancing your understanding of what those best practices are, because those libraries are already built, components are built for you. There's a lot of great good development environment for the front end people. It comes either as a desktop application for enterprise, and it also has a mobile side of it. So Okay. And the resources are great. There's actually sketch files, Adobe XD files, if you're working as a UI designer, that you can actually just download and use in those applications to help you actually design out prototypes and React components, as well as Angular components. Okay, so who uses Ant Design? Ant Financial. If you did a little research and looked at Ant Financial, you would find out that Alibaba actually owns Ant Financial. Bawe, I think is how you say it, right? James, Bawe? Okay. Smart Drive is probably the only Western company that I found out so far. I was trying to dig out how many Western companies are actually on board adopting Ant Design, but it's a very popular upcoming application. And how can we integrate it? So basic Ant Design, Ant Financial uses it, as well as Alibaba. And then there's an Angular version that integrates with it, and Bawe uses that. Now, I haven't been able to dig up anything for Ant View, because they got a brand new view. But I did dig up that Alibaba is working on a React Native competitor called Wex. It's actually a pretty cool site. I only just found out about it today. So it is mobile first on that component library. So some of the benefits and features, it supports Angular 7, and it also runs on Ionic. So if you guys are using Ionic, which is quite common, people also working on Angular, it's written in a TypeScript. So there's no, you know, you can keep everything in TypeScript for best practices, especially on enterprise. A lot of Ant Design is actually, they have a division called Ant Pro, and it's actually the enterprise version of Ant, and it's actually got a bigger library, from my understanding, and it's also used in TypeScript. Synchronizes design specifications with the Ant Design on a regular basis. So. We're going to talk some of the pros here. It's easier for startups to start projects, keeps UI consistent, as well as US best practices. Second largest React UI library, so lots of documents and forms. There's Adobe files to enhance and speed up designs if you're using Adobe XD. There's a thing called the kitchen sink. And basically, a kitchen sink is all of Ant Design's components and best practices listed. Integrates with Vue and Angular. I think in our project, we decided to use it with Vue, right? We're also utilizing it with Storybook. Storybook is like a Create React app. It's a living style guide, so our components that we are going to customize are going to go into that, and all the engineers and developers will be able just to pluck those components out. So that makes it very handy. It's a first-class enterprise. It's got a mobile UI, can be used with any data flow solution and application framework within the React landscape. And it's also, you know, quicker for development design to prototype. Okay. There are a couple cons. A lot of the documentation is in English, but I will warn you that some of it is in Chinese. Surprise, surprise. But there are a lot of great ways to ask questions. Stack Overflow has now a tag for it. It's just A-N-T-D. Also, it does have a complaint. When Sid told me about Ant Design, I actually did a little research, being the UX researcher that I am, and I went into Twitter and I tweeted it out into the universe, and I got a lot of responses back, and everybody seemed wowed over it. They love Ant Design. But there are some negatives in the sense that it feels like, to some people that are more on the creative side, that it's more like a bootstrap. So some of the complaints that you will hear sometimes in the industry about bootstrap is like, when I see a bootstrap website, I can tell it's a bootstrap website, right? So there are ways around making it more applicable to like your legacy brand or whatever, but you have to use webpacks. It's a little more painful, but not that painful. And CSS styling is done in less. If you don't know Less or you've never used Less, I highly recommend it though, because it allows you to use symbols to just basically variables to change everything globally in one place and one style sheet instead of hunting it down. So I'm going to go ahead and click out of this. And we're going to go into the actual thing, if I can find it. Okay. So this is the landing page. There's two ways you can go utilize Ant Design, and we're going to focus a little bit on the design process. And I just kind of want to give you the landscape here. It basically tells you like the design values, gives you the use cases, and these are the great principles that will educate you. One of the things that drives me a little batty is the basics of like alignment. People quite don't understand what alignment, you know, those small details are the things that are important for user experience to be, you know, delightful and from the standpoint for them to want to continue to use your app. So this basically, if you clicked on it, it'll just show you like, you know, left align. This is a very Western way of reading things, and it's very, you know, that's, you should follow those rules, and Ant Design already takes care of that for you. One of the cool things also is, even as a UI designer, I always kind of drives me crazy is like color and brand. I'll sit there for like an hour trying to figure things out, but it's, you'll see it's a lot like material design. I don't know how many of you guys have used material. Okay. So the really cool thing that I like here is like, you can actually go in here and say, I want to put my brand color, say it's that. It gives me the grayscale here. Now, I had a grandfather who had a marketing ad agency when I was growing up, and back then they did everything by hand. So he had this grayscale painted by hand in OPEC paint. And I still have it to this day, and that's the way I learned like color gradations of how to tint and how to add hues, and this does it for you automatically. So it really comes in very handy. It states here, basically gives you the perspective of what an element state are, something else that sometimes people forget about. So an Ant Design, they basically suggest that you go with, I think it was 6 is your primary color. So then here they're showing you 7 would be like, you know, a press state. Here's a, you know, on a hover state here. Obviously it's still in Chinese too, but you get the idea, right? So it's a really great component library, takes care of a lot of problems for you. And it enhances and speeds up the process. We'll go into the Ant Design for Angular here real quick, just kind of give you guys an idea. There's a great design spec here, how to actually load it in and use it. If you go into, let me just go ahead and show you what the folder looks like. Just like most general things, we have, you know, our node modules in here. We've got the config overrides JS file, which actually I created because when you want to override the styles in Ant, you have to use a webpack, and this is a plugin that you kind of use. So you have to create that file. I can share the video tutorial if anybody's interested later, basically how to do this, but it's also in the documentation. It's very simple. The package JSON, you know, you see all the dependencies and the scripts. Other than that, any questions? All right. Well, thanks, guys. Hope this helps you. Matt, you got anything? Mariah, is she here? She run off? No. Okay. Well, guys, any ideas for next month, June? Anybody want to talk? Aaron? I'll hit you up again.
I would only have to talk about AngularJS.
It's fine. Took me back memory lane. You know, and they're real. Yeah. I actually had a recruiter last week ask me if I knew anybody that had Angular 1.3 knowledge or 2 knowledge.
Is that what you do full time? No, it's full stack, but just recently I've had to deal with going back into a lot of the
regular 1.8 stuff that we have on some of our projects. So I've been just struggling and complaining about it.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, if anybody has anything else, anyone want to share anything? You guys got any job openings? Great.
I really enjoyed coming. Thanks for putting this on.
Yeah, thanks guys. I really appreciate it.
I like to say as a student, I'm just now getting the front end development, HTML, CSS, anything like that. I never heard of Angular. So I like to say now I'm getting, now I'll probably do my research and everything like that. So if you guys do just speak, if you guys do choose to do, if you do choose to speak about what you do, it would be really helpful for because I'm just now learning. And I don't like to be in your position one day. So.
Great.
Yeah. If you guys do this, it's every month?
We do it once a month, yes.
Once a month?
Yeah. Great. And we'll have to make sure that you give us a talk.
Oh,
okay.
Me?
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Okay. I don't know what I was talking about.
Anything you want.
Anything you want.
I think I would
technology
like to
wise.
Talk. I don't really know. I'm a student at the Flatiron School in Midtown.
Okay. Yeah.
Learning something new and giving a presentation on it would be awesome.
We would love to have you. That's why I actually started it. I started back when I was actually doing a boot camp at General Assembly. And I started because of two things. One, I was really shy and introverted, and I couldn't get in front of people, and I still have a hard time.
Yeah.
But it took me 4 years to finally talk at my own meetup last year. But now I've talked at conferences 3 times and given a couple talks again at meetups. But it also, I knew that when you're in boot camp, the one thing they don't tell you is you're not going to absorb and learn everything in those 12 or 20 weeks that you're at. It's a life learning process, and it takes a long time with imposter syndrome to kind of get over. And it was my way of saying, I'm going to help other people so that it helps myself, and it has, and I hope it helps everybody else. And I really appreciate everybody coming and supporting us. It's been a really great 4 years, and so anytime anybody wants to give a talk, help organize, this is your meetup. So thank you.
3 things. When it comes to speaking while you're learning, I think it's very important. It's going to make you go in depth. Even just something as trivial as what's the true or false in JavaScript. If you were just to get in front of people and have to explain it, it's gonna get you. I think the best way to be a student is start trying to be a teacher. It's gonna be tough, but that's gonna give you the depth knowledge that differentiates people in the industry. So I highly recommend for beginners, students to talk about their journey. And even for high skilled people already, if you are switching to a new technology, talk about how you switch from Vue to Angular or whatever. It's gonna force you to go in depth. And I think for the last year or year and a half, I simply realized that I don't know JavaScript at all. And I was fooling myself when I started going in depth. The second thing about hiring at Ernst & Young, I'm trying to find an Angular and a .NET person. If there's a monster like that somewhere, send me your resume. if you are solid on both, and even if you are more solid on .NET, we use the Azure environment and everything. Pretty crazy project right now, doing something that nobody else is doing. It's fun, it's stressful, and it's everything at the same time. So, and I'll interview you in a very fun way. So, yeah. And last thing, I'm trying to get better at thoughts, and this is, I just moved into this area. I was in California for 16 years, in Pittsburgh a little. So I'm trying to get into the community and stuff like that. So if you can help with crafting the code for proposal, look at Refactor and I'm should I go? I kind of have that shyness. So if you have overcome that, I would really like to see how you did overcome it. And if I can apply that too.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, definitely. I mean, we're all here to help. We all are going, we all want the same thing. We're all going to help each other, no matter what the rest of society is telling you. We're all there to help each other. So,
Greg Dunn. I'm with Delta Airlines. And we are moving most of our sites over to a Node backend and Angular front end. So we do have several Angular positions open. If anybody's interested, feel free to talk to me here or just hit me up on the meetup. It's like
random
that
my
mom's a flight. Oh, she
does. So,
the flight
there.
<flight. laughs>
<It's laughs>
incredible.
I interned there 2 years. The flying is amazing.
I went to Miami last week. Just for fun.
That's
nice. Just jump on a plane.
I went to Argentina for 8 hours.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They definitely were like, 8 hours?
You know,
would you
have
terrorists.
A team that does it? Korean Airlines does it right now. That's actually one of our big partners, so we're going to be doing lots of work with them. So them and Air Brands.
Awesome. So you know what you want to talk about?
I don't. I was going to actually come after you and see if you could offer me some guidance.
Okay, yeah, definitely.
I might do a talk too.
Okay, great. Anybody else while we're at it? We're on a roll.
I just want to know where to start. Like,
whatever you're learning about.
Right now we're learning about Python.
Okay, that's a good thing to know. I mean, there's no, the one thing I've learned is like, if you can really understand one programming language, the second one come a lot easier.
But my favorites are like HTML and CSS. I know they're like the easiest, but I think once you put
them in. No, they're not the easiest.
They're not, well, comes easy for me, I guess. But once you like visually see what you created, I think that's like, the best part of CSS.
Yeah. HTML CSS cost $40 million, I believe, in lost revenue to Macy's because of the way they placed the button and then the user experience. So a lot of time, and that's one of my pet peeves in the JavaScript, in the front-end community, we push for JavaScript. Everybody's about JavaScript, the framework, blazing, and everything like that. But at the core, people are consuming your HTML and CSS first. And there's a whole art and science to what Frenz is doing here. If people cannot intuitively like navigate your application, they cannot know like all the fancy blazing stuff that you have behind. And that cost $40 million to when they switch the button from left to right, this did a pure A/B testing, they realized that they were losing $40 million in sales just because of that button. So HTML CSS is not simple. You know, it's a whole art. So the whole trinity of front-end development, you have to be solid at it. You know, JavaScript can be like, the golden child right now. But without those two guys, you leave money on the table. So it's not simple.
Like our professor would scare us, like, oh, you just lost the company $50,000. Like, what are you doing?
Yeah.
But yeah.
That's why I got a user test.
Yeah.
Yes. User test.
You can't rush things through, as painful as it is. But
guys. Company I work for, but we're also hiring.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Where's that?
We're up in Alpharetta.
Okay.
And as you can tell from the name, we're like in the Bitcoin space. And it's been really fun to work on. I started there just in October, and it's been awesome. So we're like smart people, get your hands dirty in a new kind of industry. Yep.
Great. What's your name again? Bob?
Bob.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, if anybody that wants me to, in our next email, send out the job postings that you have available. We do have a job board, which is I still can't figure out how to navigate since speaking of bad UI, because Meetup changed to mobile first, but they forgot about the people that actually have to use those things for the CMS applications. I'm still trying to figure out what the job board is and get back to it myself. So one last thing, I'll let everybody go. There's probably going to be a charity / pairing up with probably some people to help the Leadership Academy with Maynard Jackson Youth Foundation, where we're probably gonna do a workshop. Want to create a workshop where they can learn to create like maybe a simple to-do app, and they can have a choice of either learning the front end or the UX or the back end. So we're looking for volunteers to kind of just line up and start
time slotting that with who able bodies, so I can get that going sometime in the summer. Yeah, definitely would love that. Okay, awesome. Thanks again, guys. Drive safely.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Are you on that meetup?
I got you.
Put your name and phone number. How's
that? That's even better.
How's that? Now I have you in my contact.
Yeah.
Right there.
No problem.
I think that one is going to be fun.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you.
Yeah,
so nice
to meet you. Yeah,
it's
nice to meet you. No, the traffic from Alpharetta to here is crazy, so today is a week, it should be all right.
Yeah. I mean, they have different ones.
Yeah.
I love it every day. West Palm's kind of lame.
We had a guy 4 months ago, who came in. He was from Delta. I think he was the top of angular elements. It was the first time he spoke about that, and I was like, totally sorry. So you can take a legacy project.
Exactly.
Yeah, like this thing,
exactly.
I said, that solves like
the problem. Yeah, the whole line system.
Like,
you know,
you can own the legacy, I'm just going to own this angular element.
You learn
yes.
Exactly.
Right? That's what it is.
So I'm like,
That is sweet.
Sweet.
I am.
Okay, good.
I thought it was something I thought it was something.